Still to come on the NewsHour, the never-ending battle over pornography with the Reverend Jerry Falwell, Penthouse publisher Bob Guccione, and others. One of the first things Edwin Meese did when becoming Attorney General was to launch a new study of pornography, a study to determine if there was a demonstrable cause and effect between dirty books, movies, etc., and dirty crimes. The action gave new life to an argument that never ends and never will. It's the one over what exactly is pornography, what, if anything, should be done about it, and what, if anything, can be done about it without violating the constitutional rights of free speech. We engage that subject in a major way tonight with the Reverend Jerry Falwell, Penthouse publisher Bob Guccione, Dorchen Leedholt of Women Against Pornography, and Carol Vance of Feminists Against Censorship. First, a setup report from San Francisco by Kathy McAnally of public station KQED.
There is plenty of money to be made in America on sexually explicit materials. Pornography is an $8 billion a year industry. Last year, 40% of all videotape recorder owners bought or rented an X-rated movie. These trends don't please some members of the feminist community, who charge that pornography, which shows women in postures of sexual subjugation, can lead its consumers to commit violent acts against unwilling women and children. Feminist attorney Catherine McKinnon has testified at many hearings like these across the country, urging local governments to pass ordinances which would allow a woman who claims she's been damaged by pornography to sue the person responsible for the material.
What has happened with the ordinance and its being proposed is that for the first time women see in public an articulation of an injury that they were not even able to conceive. The pornography says authoritatively, this is what you want, this is what you like, this is what a woman is for, and this is protected by the First Amendment.
The movement for anti-pornography laws has been embraced by conservative women as well, who have finally found a feminist issue that they can support.
Yes, don't you think it's interesting that the feminists and the traditional types have gotten together on something? We do agree on that. We agree that women are being exploited, children are being exploited, and that we definitely need to have a law that will allow us to do something about that.
The most recent effort to do something about violent pornography on the local level occurred earlier this year in Los Angeles. After 9 months of study, that county's Commission on the Status of Women asked the Board of Supervisors to approve an anti-pornography ordinance co-authored by Catherine McKinnon.
Well, the ordinance defines pornography as the sexually explicit subordination of women through pictures or words. That also includes a list of elements. Those elements include women presented as taking sexual pleasure in pain, humiliation, or rape, being dismembered or tortured, being penetrated by objects or animals, and a number of other concrete elements.
The board rejected most of the proposed anti-pornography law, fearing a lengthy court battle over the law's constitutionality. Susan McGreevy is the women's rights attorney for the American Civil Liberties Union of Southern California.
What I would see is an absolute reimposition of essentially right-wing patriarchal values that says that sex is bad, that there is no such thing as sex-positive literature. All right, that sex is not something that we want to encourage in the culture, and a closing down and a reimposition of kind of what I would call the virgin mentality, that women are best when they are virgins, and I'm not sure that that's something that everybody in the culture wants at this point.
What continues to inspire debate over pornography is the question of whether it leads to sexual violence against women. In the past few years, new studies have shown a possible link between violent pornography and abusive behavior. Dr. Mimi Silbert conducted a study of violence against street prostitutes in San Francisco. Many of them were victims of rape.
Of the 193 incidents of rape, 25% of them involved the issue of pornography on the part of the rapist. And what happened is that the rapist, during the course of the rape, brought the subject up, either of a specific pornographic movie or of things that he had seen, essentially verbally saying, I know you like it, I've seen this happen in such and such a movie, and escalated in the violence.
At the University of California at Los Angeles, Dr. Neil Malamuth studies sexually violent media and those who watch it.
The aggression against women often suggests that somehow the victim desires to be assaulted and derive some pleasure from it, which is very seldom, if any, at all the case with aggression against men. And we have found that in general, people become more accepting, more tolerant of violence against women. And that is not violence that is specifically limited to the kind of violence they saw in the movie, but more general, including wife battering and aggression in dating situations, as well as rape.
But for many, the crucial question remains, should there be any restraint on the flow of ideas, even those that most people find offensive?
People had better wake up, had better realize that there is a serious attack going on the First Amendment right now, and that if they aren't careful, they're going to wake up and find a hole in the middle of their morning newspaper.
As we saw earlier, pornography and efforts to control it have drawn different responses from politically active women. We hear two of those views now from Dortchen Liethold, founding member of the Women Against Pornography, and Carol Vance of the Feminist Anti-Censorship Task Force. Ms. Liethold, in your argument for local ordinances, which your organization is supporting, you say women are directly hurt by pornographic material. How are they hurt? Give us some examples of how they're hurt.
We're hearing from these examples more and more. I think what's happening now with the abuse of women through pornography, we're very much in the same place that we were perhaps 10 years ago with rape, maybe 7 years ago with wife battery. Within the last 3 years, since the introduction of the Civil Rights Anti-Pornography Ordinance, scores upon scores of women have spoken out about their abuse through pornography, and it ranges from women who were introduced into prostitution by pimps using pornography, who used the pornography to show them what to do, who forced them to pose for pornography. One such woman testified recently before the U.S. Attorney General's Commission on Pornography. Another woman who was forced into child pornography testified. Later she ended up posing for pornography as an adult. A woman who was whose husband used pornography compulsively, addictively. He began to bring it into the house constantly. She couldn't get it out of the house. He ended up forcing her to do the things that he was seeing in the magazines. Later on, he forced their two daughters to do the same things. This woman and both of the two girls testified as well. So what we're finding is, first of all, pornography is a practice of sexual abuse, that real women are being abused in the sex industry to make these materials, that these materials are then used against a second line of victims, women and children throughout the country. And as it stands now, there's nothing that we can do legally to get any kind of justice when we are hurt in these ways. And the Civil Rights Anti-Pornography Ordinance is a way of empowering victims, primarily women and children, to do something when we're injured as a result of pornography.
Mm-hmm. Ms. Vance, do you believe that women are not hurt by pornography?
I think women are hurt by sexism in all media, and I think feminists are right to critique that no matter where it occurs. But I think the zeroing in on pornography as if it is the central cause of women's oppression is very misguided. I think many of the abuses, you know, Dortchen has mentioned, it is already illegal to coerce people. It is already a felony to abuse them. Marital rape is illegal in many states, as it should be. It should be in all. I think as feminists, we object to male abuse of power and male dominance, but to locate this in sexually explicit material, I think, is very mistaken.
How do you respond to that?
Well, what we're looking at is an $8 billion a year industry that makes more than the film and record industries combined, that basically functions as sex education for the men and boys of this country. It has a tremendous impact on their attitudes towards women, on the way men and boys treat women. It's a practice of sex discrimination. And
could I stop you there and ask you, how do you define pornography? What would you have ordinances against, or ordinances that would permit women whom you see as victims to challenge under the in the way you describe?
Well, I'll offer a legal definition, the same definition that the Civil Rights Anti-Pornography Ordinance offers: the graphic, sexually explicit subordination of women through pictures or words, that also includes a number of elements ranging from dehumanizing women as sex objects to raping, mutilating, battering women.
That accurately describes pornography, and that's the material we're referring to.
Now, does some of that stretch as far as Mr. Guccione's magazine?
Oh, absolutely. I think that Mr. Guccione is decidedly a pornographer, and his material is very characteristic of pornography. It ranges from dehumanizing women as pets in his centerfolds and the pictures that accompany that. If you think about what it means to think about a woman as a pet, as simply a sexual plaything, as not an equal human being at all, to pictures in Mr. Guccione's magazine of women being strung up from trees, bound with ropes like sides of beef, pictures of adult women dressed up as little girls with surrounded by child's toys, a cartoon of a man holding a gun to a woman's head as he penetrates her. The caption reads, "You don't have to worry about getting pregnant. I've taken every precaution." Mr. Guccione's magazine is filled with violent, sadomasochistic material. It dehumanizes women. That's what we're talking about.
We'll give you an opportunity to respond in a moment, just to keep this on the feminist argument. Do you agree with this definition of pornography?
Well,
or
no.
Do you agree that the materials she's describing are pornographic?
All right. Number one, I think we use this word pornography at our own peril. We each use it believing we mean the same thing as the other person. We almost never do. To Reverend Falwell, pornography includes sex education material, which he and his group would try to get out of schools. It includes gay and lesbian literature. It would include a great deal of recent feminist art and literature as well. That is not what you mean when you say pornography,
I think you probably mean yet another thing.
So I think it is critical that we instead use a term that's sexually explicit pictures or literature, and then try to describe what we're really looking at. The chief point is the perception of sexually explicit literature is very subjective. When we look at it, we draw on our personal experience, our history.
Yeah, I'd like to respond to that very quickly. I mean, the root of the word pornography means writings about female sexual slaves. That's what pornography is. But right now, women have absolutely no legal recourse. When we're coerced into performing for pornography, there's nothing that we can do to get at that material. Women can be filmed or photographed in the course of a rape. Once that rape gets out there, it goes on to the marketplace and it's protected speech. There's nothing we can do about that now.
What would be the effect, in the view of your organization, of instituting these ordinances, local ordinances around the country?
Well, I think it's important to understand how these ordinances would work. Individuals could bring complaints to affirmative action boards or civil court judges, depending on the way the locality worked. Under the law, there are four causes of action. One is that pornography was involved in the commission of a rape, and that would have to be directly causally proved, which is next to impossible to do. Secondly, coercing someone into pornographic performance. And I think, number one, coercion is already criminal. And two, I think we're ignoring for the moment that some women choose to engage in pornographic modeling and pictures, and that's a choice the way women make other choices. Thirdly, forcing pornography on someone, perhaps in sexual harassment at a workplace, that is already covered under existing sexual harassment law. So to me, the main clause of the law, the main cause of action, is the fourth, the trafficking provision, in which an individual could sue for damages and the removal of the material in question by injunction from public view.
You don't approve of that?
No, I don't. I think it's called censorship, whether it's done prior to publication or after publication. I think also the possibility of individuals filing an endless series of civil suits against not just the producers of the sexually explicit material, but the actors in it, the distributors, the drugstores who sell it, the bookstores who sell it, the art galleries who hang it, creates a very chilling effect on the production of a great deal of culture.
Well, what we're finding is women call us, women write us, they tell us about abuse in which pornography was centrally involved, and the causal link is sometimes totally undeniable. For example, last year, two little boys, ages 9 and 11, raped a baby girl, first with a coat hanger, then with pencils, and they murdered her. When the investigators asked the children where they got these ideas, they led them to their parents' pornography magazines. The causality is so clear. Very often, rapists use pornography as handbooks or refer to the pornography in the course of the rape.
Which is your chief concern, the idea that pornography leads directly to violence against women in one form or another, or that it keeps women second-class citizens, to quote one of the other members of your group?
I think the two are inseparable. What pornography does is it makes every woman the actual or potential victim of sexual violence. That is a kind of discrimination. That has a huge impact on how we function in this society. It functions as a kind of terrorism. It keeps us silent. It effectively censors us. It keeps us out of participation in all kinds of public life. So I think that the two, discrimination and violence against women, cannot be separated.
Mr. Guccione, does pornography as defined by Ms. Leedholt, hurt women?
I don't understand her definition. And so far, we have not had a cogent definition of what pornography really is.
She said, among other things, at one end of the spectrum...
That which demeans women. This is a totally subjective affair. And what demeans women, in her opinion, may not demean women, in my opinion, or yours, or someone else's. Let me just answer by quoting two sentences from a former head of the National Organization of Women. She was the national president for, I think, 3 years. Her name was Karen DeCrow. She was hired by the Knight Ridley group of newspapers to do a hatchet job on the Vanessa Williams issue of Penthouse. She read the magazine. She went on to say, I couldn't do what I was asked to do. And these are her reasons. And as I say, there are only two sentences. She said, on the September issue, I could find no put-down of women, no suggestion that women were asked to be exploited, hurt, oppressed, or even asked to cook dinner. There is no suggestion that women be forced to have sex against their will. There is no hint that children are the sole responsibility of women. It contains one article urging that fathers take equal care of their children during marriage or after divorce. There is no suggestion that men are intellectually superior. She says, Penthouse, sexy yes, sexist no.
Well, I think what Penthouse did to Vanessa Williams is a classic example of subordination, and the subordination of women is the key phrase in our definition of pornography. What Penthouse...
In case anybody's forgotten, Miss Williams was the former Miss America who resigned,
yes.
resigned her throne or her crown after the pictures appeared in Penthouse.
Yes. Yeah. Against Vanessa Williams' will, without her consent, over her objections, Penthouse published a whole
Excuse
state
me,
of photographs
she did not
of her.
Object.
What Penthouse did...
She signed a model release.
Let her speak, and then you can speak.
What Penthouse did was, of course, it destroyed her career, for one. It also was an incredible insult to the tens of thousands of black women around the country for whom Vanessa Williams represented some kind of achievement.
Baloney.
Baloney.
The black press in the United States was the most moderate in dealing with this subject. It was the white press that tried to make a racial issue out of it. There was certainly no racial issue whatsoever. And let me say something else, too. When Vanessa Williams did these photographs, she signed a model release. Not only did she sign a model release, but she signed a model application form when she joined the photographic studio for whom she worked. Please let me finish. In which she said, I want these magazines, in her own writing, I want these magazines to be published. Where did she want, I want these photographs to be published. You remember the photographs. Where did she want them published? In the Ladies' Home Journal, in Popular Mechanics, or a magazine like Penthouse?
Vanessa Williams,
she signed a release, she gave the right to the photographer to publish those photographs. It was anticipated that they should be published.
Brief comment, and then we'd like to move on. Just give her a chance to talk now.
While she was Miss America, she was contacted constantly by the photographer. She didn't have either the good sense or the gentlewomanliness to telephone him back to get in touch with him to find out what he wanted.
Vanessa Williams called the publication of those photographs a rape. It was a rape, and right now under existing law, there's nothing that women like Vanessa Williams
can
do.
But why did she do it?
With our civil rights ordinance, she could
sue you. But why did she do it in the first place? No,
and she could get an injunction against that material.
She is suing me for $400 million, and I guarantee you she will win.
Mr. Farwell in Atlanta, what is your view on the charge that pornography demeans and actually leads to physical violence against women?
I don't think there's any question about that, and I would agree totally with Dorchin that Vanessa, even if she did sign a model release, it is like saying that if a youngster, a teenager, signs an agreement that you may kill me, that I then have the right to kill you. In reality, Penthouse magazine destroyed Vanessa. Well,
so Vanessa Williams is the only Miss America that the world recalls, with the possible single exception of Bess Meyerson. She's had more work since she was thrown out of the pageant than she ever would have had. She would have passed into oblivion like every other single Miss America before.
I can name more than two Miss Americas, and
go ahead.
Phyllis George right on through. But I
right
I
on
say,
through
may,
what? That's
but,
it. But Phyllis George and Bess Meyerson.
May I say to you that you nor no one else had the right to take
Jerry,
that young
I
girl
have the legal right.
Mr. Guccione, just let him finish
the world,
his sentence.
And there are very few people in the world that would have done that, and only a pornographic magazine would, and Dorchin is exactly right. It was verbal and pictorial rape, and she may have plenty of work down the road, But her character and reputation have been virtually.
No other magazine would have done it. People magazine ran two cover stories on her after we broke the news.
Let's bring Ms. Vance into this. What do you think of this?
Well, first of all, I'm a social scientist, so I'd like to comment on the so-called causal proof between sexual explicit material and violence against women. First of all, there have been some limited studies done in a laboratory setting. As a social scientist, even the authors of it, Donnerstein and Malamuth, have limited and cautioned against the interpretation. I think it's quite absurd to base social policy, let alone law, on the basis of studies that are preliminary, need to be repeated and replicated, and that are merely now.
You're saying there's no proof of a direct correlation between the consumption of pornography and violent acts against women?
Using accepted standards in social science, the evidence is now quite weak and preliminary.
Ms. Lee,
and I would like to comment on this use of so-called victim testimony. I think if we look back historically in the World War II, 50s period, we see a vast number of people willing to testify that homosexuality caused communism, that eating white bread caused mental illness. I don't mean to demean the testimony of women. It's sincere. But there are many women who could testify on all sorts of things, that going out to work leads to juvenile delinquency, that having a job leads to divorce. Surely we can't base social policy on these individual testimonies.
And when a woman who has been raped testifies that her rapist used pornography like a textbook, I think that the causal link is pretty clear. But the truth of the matter is, since 1976, every major experimental study has shown the same thing. It's shown that small amounts of violent pornography or large amounts of demeaning, degrading, anti-woman pornography, large amounts of pornography, lead men to develop attitudes and, in laboratory situations, behaviors of violence against women.
Ms. Vance?
Well, certainly, when we use the term pornography, again, we allude to this huge, vast array of material. The films used in these laboratory studies are very particular rape scenes in which women appear to initially resist and then agree. Most pornography does not depict that scenario. So to generalize from these studies to all pornography is totally unwarranted.
That's wrong. That's totally wrong. One, Dolph Zillman has shown large groups of students standard, not explicitly violent pornography, and he's found that in large doses, the men develop the same anti-woman attitudes and behaviors that they develop from the explicitly violent pornography.
Well, Jim, unfortunately, in social science.
Yep. Mr. Falwell.
There are 102 associate pastors.
Thank you, Mr. Falwell. I'm sorry to have to cut you off, but that is the end of our time. Thank you for joining us from Atlanta, Mr. Guccione, Ms. Vance, and Ms. Leithold. Thank you. Mm-hmm.